Okay, so let's start. Respected dignitaries and my dear participants, Namaskar and very good afternoon to one and all. I, Dipali Jindal, Junior Consultant NIDM, welcomes you all in today's webinar on the topic Geospatial Technologies for Flood Management. So before we start our session, I request the convener of this program, Dr. Amrit Lal Hardar, to kindly give a quick introduction about the webinar. Over to you, Dr. Amrit Lal Hardar.
Okay, thank you, Dipali ji, and it is highly. I would also welcoming our distinguished speaker, Dr. Bhanumurthy sahab, and our head of department, Professor Surya Prakash sahab, and other panelists as well as attendees, the respected attendees also. So they have also joined now. I am welcoming them, and keeping in view of this pandemic, we should keep in mind that safe distance at least 2 meter, and this hand sanitization should be making, and time to time hand washing and other things should be done. And also the vaccination is going on, and we should not skip off that program. We should take this vaccine in proper way. At least 2 doses of vaccine should be inoculated. Now, this is the season for flood in India. A lot of states are in grip of flood, and we know this geospatial technology, especially for the satellite technology, satellite data, satellite image, in combination with the GIS technology, is giving a lot of relief, especially for the flood management and other management also. The satellite image is an integral part for the disaster management, and it is extensively using for different kind of mapping, monitoring, and damage assessment for different kinds of disaster as well as flood management, flood purposes also. The satellite images are having synoptic view, multispectral coverage, and also multi-temporal. Due to that in each remote places and where people cannot go, we are getting the information as quick as, and it is easy for the decision maker to put the appropriate decision and to save the people, and how much to assess the damage, how much damage is there, and proper relief for them, and also rehabilitation, all the things should be done. In the inaccessible areas, it is the only means to get the actual scenario in this remote sensing and GIS also. And what is the severity of the flood, we are also getting from the geospatial technology. The GIS, it is giving information, and as well as it is preparing the map, the whatever is being derived from the satellite image, and it can give the quick decision also, and various purposes, it is helping for mitigating and management of the disaster, even in flood also. So nowadays, this lot of satellite are in operation, and especially the few satellites I'll be named, that which are responsible for this flood management as well as disaster purposes. You know that RESAT, that is RESAT-2B, which is launched during 2019-22, May 22, it is active, and it is giving proper information for the flood. Similarly, some geostationary satellite, that INSAT-3D, that is launched in 2016, in September 8, and it gives the climate and environment, disaster management system, all the information are given. Similarly, still old, that was the INSAT-3D, that was in 2013, July 26. These are active and still giving a lot of information for the flood and other disaster also. Now, how the satellite images are used for disaster management? The satellite imagery, GIS maps can give the emergency and disaster response to the official in a lot of OLD information for the assessment, analysis, monitoring of natural resources, and it facilitates the state government, central government, and ministry, and good administrator to get the relief in different, say, hurricane, tornado, cyclone, even tsunami also, and it is giving. Now, the objective of this today's webinar is how the geospatial technology work to provide the relief for the public and government department for the different kinds of natural resources and infrastructure. Similarly, it can assess the crop damage and other damages also, and how it could be built up. This technology is also giving a lot of information for early warning and early warning system also. So I'll not go far more than keeping in view the time. Now we are having a very eminent speaker who was there in NRSC Hyderabad. He's a lot of experience. He will share his experience of, with the use of this geospatial technology. And we are fortunate enough that we can get a chance to hear him. Thank you. And over to Deepali, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving such a nice introduction and brief introduction about the webinar. So moving ahead, now I request our professor and head, Surya Prakash, sir, to kindly take over the stage to address our participants with his keynote address. Over to you, Dr. Surya Prakash, sir. Surya, sir, are you there?
Yeah, joining just.
Sure, thank you.
Thank you, Deepali ji, and good afternoon to all the distinguished experts of today and the distinguished guests for today's inaugural program and all the delegates and participants of our today's program. First of all, I would like to express our heartfelt thanks to ED-NIDM Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal ji, Vishesh Seva Medal, who has actually encouraged, motivated, and permitted us to undertake this activity jointly with the involvement of the experts from NRSC, the former Associate Director, Dr. Bhanu Murthy ji, who has kindly agreed at a very short notice to share his rich experience. I know he's carrying a lot of knowledge with him in the field of disaster management. He was that one of the key persons in the field of disaster management who has utilized the spatial technologies, particularly the satellite imageries and informations for the purpose of disaster risk reduction and resilience. The NRSC had also actually started a disaster management support program, and they are contributing a lot through various projects and programs related to disaster management with support from our Ministry of Home Affairs as well as Department of Space. So these are technologies, as told by my colleague Dr. Amrit Lal Hardarji, they are very special and unique in their nature, because wherever we cannot access the areas and cannot see the things at one instance, we can visualize all those inaccessible remote areas and regional views through these satellite images and using the geospatial technologies. So one of the major challenges we often face, particularly in risk assessment as well as in damage and loss assessment in the immediate aftermath of any disaster situation, is the areas affected or likely to be affected by a specific disaster, and also the degree of the losses or the damages that are occurring or likely to occur in those areas with respect to the elements that are getting exposed to a specific hazard. I remember the recent times when disaster took place in the early morning at around 10:30 a.m. on 7th February, Sunday morning, in Uttarakhand state, Chamoli district, Joshimath block. We were actually looking for where it has happened and when did it actually start and which are the areas covered and where did it actually struck and when did it struck. and how, which are those all elements which have been affected adversely by this specific event. And at that time, the National Remote Sensing Center actually came to our rescue, and they actually took the satellite images and made all the assessments of what had actually happened at the source, and then how it has actually propagated and got transmitted down to the downstream parts of the Dholi Ganga and also the Rishi Ganga river valley. And these things we could not decipher otherwise looking at a particular locality or a particular slope, which could have been actually well assessed through this regional view. And this helped us understand the event better than the other means of it, our understanding, as well as it has also given us the ideas about the likelihoods of the potential disaster that may subsequently follow because of formation of a lake, which got actually formed due to damming of the Rishi Ganga by the debris which was brought by that particular event. So all these calculations in terms of the hydrological modeling, forecasting, prediction, as well as risk assessment, damage and loss assessments, and subsequently planning for our response and rehabilitation, recovery, the use of satellite images and geospatial technologies has been very much appreciated. And not only by this, the or NRSC Department of Space had also prepared certain atlas along the pilgrimage route of the Uttarakhand state, which actually also helped us understand the landslides that are likely to happen or the vulnerable and susceptible areas where the landslides can cause damage or losses. So the various things have been done. I think more details will be shared by our experts. This I'm telling you both in terms of floods, landslides, earthquakes, and multi-hazard approach. These spatial technologies, particularly satellite images, have been very, very useful. And I remember last year when we were having a lot of floods, our Union Home Minister Shri Amit Shah ji took up a meeting with our DM authorities and the various functionaries and officials. And we were discussing that despite all our best knowledge available and all our endeavors to mitigate the impacts of the floods, still we are having more and more losses. The data indicates that the losses because of hydrometeorological events particularly, they are still on the rise. One of the factors cited is the changing climatic conditions, the unplanned developments and urbanization, as well as the growth of population in the susceptible areas. So the question was that despite the available knowledge about the forecast and models available for flood early warning and a dedicated agency, Central Water Commission, which is issuing regular early warnings related to the levels, discharges of the water in various basins and the river systems, why we have not been able to avert, prevent or mitigate the flood incidences or their impacts. So we will try to see and find out how these technologies, they can help us in managing the disaster situations and also reducing their risk and enhancing the resilience of the communities likely to be exposed. So with these words, I would say thanks to the host for providing me this opportunity for sharing my ideas. And I wish all the best to our team who is organizing this particular event and also to our experts. And I urge the participants to kindly do ask questions so that it becomes bilateral discussions and interactions and more beneficial in the interest of the participants. So these words, I thank you all for this opportunity, and back to you, Ms. Dipali.
Thank you so much, sir. I think your address was nothing short of excellent. It not only, I think, informed us about the floods, landslide, earthquake, but also about the multi-hazard events. Thank you once again so much. So now moving ahead further, I would like to invite our first speaker, Dr. V. Bhanumurthy, Associate Director, Retired Associate Director, NRC Hyderabad. And he is going to deliver the lecture on the topic Geospatial Technologies for the Flood Management. So before he start the presentation, I would like to give a brief introduction about Dr. V. Bhanumurthy. He did his qualification in BE Civil Engineering and MS in Spatial Information Technology, and completed his doctorate in Emergency Management. And he shouldered technical and managerial responsibilities in NRSC ISRO for 37 years in various capacities. He also played a key role in the application of remote sensing and GIS for the natural resources management, sustainable development, and disaster risk reduction. Also, he has interacted with ministries at center and state governments to popularize the space technology applications. He has served as a project director and was responsible for successful implementation of national database for emergency management. Focal point and key interface to Ministry of Home Affairs, NDMA, MEA, from NRC and ISRO, and he has been identified as the nodal officer from the Department Space for National Crisis Management Group, Cabinet Secretariat, New Delhi. So with these words, I would like to invite now Dr. V. Bhanumurthy, sir, to kindly take over the stage, and please address our participants with your presentation, sir.
Thank you for the nice introduction you have given. Dr. Major M.K. Jindal, Executive Director, NIDM. Dr. Surya Prakash, Head GMR Division, NIDM, and Amrit Lal Haldar, the Consultant NIDM, and Deepali Jindal, Consultant NIDM, and other panelists online, and my dear participants. First of all, let me give convey my thanks to the National Institute of Disaster Management for giving an opportunity to share with you my experience on geospatial technologies for disaster management. Dr. Surya Prakash has given a very comprehensive view of the recent disasters that have taken place, not only with regard to the conventional floods in the major river systems, the floods that are going to be caused by the landslide blocking a river system, which is typically which has happened at Tapovan, among other things. And he has given a very good concept, and most of the things which I want to cover also in my presentation. Before I start, let me share. I hope everybody able to listen to my voice and the video.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
See, just one thing, the voice is a bit low, so you need to pick your mic up.
Yes, sir. Let me share first. Video is there. You are able to see?
Yes, sir. We are able to see.
Okay. Start. It's taking some time. I don't know. System. The problem with my system or anything else. For taking the slide, it is taking time. Okay. My dear participants, let me share some of my thoughts with regard to the geospatial technologies for flood management. When you want to deal with the floods, first and foremost thing, we have to understand where and when flood has occurred. Dr. Supriya Prakash, just a few minutes back, he has mentioned that in Dhauli Ganga, there is a disaster has occurred. We have no idea where it has occurred, why it has occurred, and everything. So first of all, you must know where, because the response mechanism depends upon the situation where it is going to be. If it is, say, Uttarakhand, which has been taken place in last time in 2013, with the temple, a lot of flash floods have occurred. At that time, the evacuation is through air, totally, because all ghats have been blocked. There is no way surfacely we can transport the evacuation of people, and mostly it has been. Suppose a major flood has occurred in Brahmaputra, is Lakhimpur district, the situation is going to be people will be moved by boats. So that depend upon the location where it has occurred, it plays a very important role. What type of mechanism you have to deploy, what type of response mechanism you have to deploy. And second very important point is when, because whenever the flood has occurred at particular time of time, any delay, it is, the damage is going to be exponentially high. When it has occurred, when likely to be occurred, suppose a flood warning has been given, you must be able to position the response forces like NDRF at appropriate locations so that the damage to the life and mobile property can be at the minimum. And the second important point when you want to deal with it is you require reasons for that flooding. It is a overland flow, it is a breach in embankment, or a landslide has blocked a stream and an impoundment has taken place and it is suddenly has come up, or a cloudburst. There are so many events which have recently we have seen. There is a flash floods due to cloudburst. There is a flash floods have occurred due to avalanche or a rockfall. There is a flash, there is a heavy flooding due to heavy rainfall, which has occurred in the major cities. The reasons for flooding, because you have to tackle the reasons, you have to plug in so that every time we'll be learning lessons from each of the events. So you must know the reasons so that you have to incorporate in mitigation mechanism. These are the possibilities which are going to occur. The third is the magnitude of impact. If it is a small event, it is fine, but it is a major. The magnitude is a relative term. When you compare with the major flood in Brahmaputra River, which inundates a few lakhs of kilometers of area, with when compared to a small flood that has occurred in somewhere in non-prominent flood areas or in hilly areas like Manipal, Manipura, people will think it is a small, but no, for those locality people, that itself is a major. Magnitude and its impact, what is the impact it is creating, is very important. And you must know whether situation is progressing or recession. Suppose the catchment rainfall is going to continue, the situation is going to become worse. And if it is reducing, this good news, because you have to deploy more number of persons, relief teams, if it is in progressive stage. If it is the recession stage, you have to redeploy the people to other areas. And what needs to be done? This is the most, at the time of crisis, the decision making is the most crucial point. Won't be any communication. There won't be any, even a transport also we are unable to reach because it may be blocked. And in all, against all odds, the commissioner or the administrator who is there in the scene as an incident commander has to take a decision crucially. For those things, at that time, he looks for information. Where I can get this information. For such type of things, geospatial data tools and spatial technologies come into a lot. And this is a simple, I think, let me speak, this is my, okay. And what is, this is a small statistics which are taken from Central Water Commission, which is a nodal ministry for flood management in the country. The extent, magnitude too, just to give you a glimpse of the magnitude, the maximum area affected is about 17 plus million hectares, which has happened in 1978. Similarly, the number of lives have been lost is about 11,000 plus, that is in 1977, that is Divi cyclone. Afterwards, there is a cyclone early warning mechanism has come into the picture. Loss due to cyclones is become very minimal, which are taken. Damage to the crops is about 17,000 million hectares, which have taken place, or the cross is about rupees crores, which have taken place and everything. Crop area is more than 12 million hectares. This is the extent of, this is one of the most annual recurring disaster in the country. And there is a structural and non-structural management measures have been identified and Rashtriya Bhar Ayog or by Central Water Commission in the documents which are, this is also taken from there everything. As an abstraction, first forecasting mechanism has to be improved. This is first and foremost thing, is to give a forecast. The flood forecasting is quite possible, and the Central Water Commission is giving the flood forecast in most of the river basins. In Indus also, I understand they have started. Previously, it is not there. Now in the river sub-river systems also, they are giving flood warning and everything. And another thing, flood hazard zonation maps are for plain zoning, which can be made available so that the development of activity can be regulated in the flood proofing is another way of thing. And these, one of the things which have been given in RBI is living with the floods. You have to live with it. That may be more economical than investing of the other thing. With regard to the structural creation of reservoirs, diversion of acres, you can read into it. But most of the structural measures that have been implemented in the country is the embankments. Even construction of embankment is a point of discussion whether it will increase or decrease. Kosi, take an example of Kosi is an embankment on both the sides. First of all, when the embankment has been constructed, there is a idea in the human beings will say it is protected. In no time, that area will get developed. And in the event of breach, once it is developed, any breach has occurred in the embankment, if it is not maintained properly, the extent of damage is going to be very, very high. When there is no embankment, people know how to live with the floods. They will move away when the flood comes. They know very well, especially in Assam, when you go to the Char Islands or whatever it may be, whatever they see, they know how to live with it. When there is no flood, they'll go and cultivate some garden crops and everything, come back. When there are floods, they'll come out. They know how to live with it. But when you give a protection, it gives channel improvements, spoying, embankments, bank protection works, river training works. These are all structural management practices. But despite of any of the things, to plan any structural measure or non-structural measure, what you require is data, appropriate technology. Today, we have got host of geospatial technology. Call it as remote sensing technology, GIS technology, GPS technology, location services, or LIDAR technology or software. There is a host of technologies are available which play a very vital role in providing appropriate solution to the problems. But please remember, every technology has got its advantages as well as limitations. Single technology may not be able to provide a solution, complete solution to your problem. What you have to do is you have to a right mix of technologies you have to adopt so that you can get optimum results. Suppose you take a mobile technology, it has got a connectivity is very high wherever you go it, but at the same time there is a limitation, there may not be a coverage, or maybe signal will be drop out. But because of that limitation, we cannot throw out. Similarly, space technology has got a tremendous potential which gives a synoptic view, or maybe a repeated temporal interval, so you can get a satellite picture. But when you go for an optical remote sensing, when there is a cloud, you will get the picture of the cloud, but not on the below the ground. It has got a limitation. So if that type of things, you must identify what are the limitations, how I can go about. Just to give a glimpse of various type of technologies, the satellite images.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Few participants are saying they are unable to hear clearly. So.
Let me see.
So just keep your mic close and think, I think everything will be clear.
Okay, now?
Now it's better, sir.
Yeah, I will hold the mic. I think maybe it is. Now it is fine?
Yes, sir. Fine? It's fine. It's fine,
okay,
sir.
Okay, I'll. Yeah, I think, okay, I'll hold it and speak. That is better. Maybe because it is going down. And we got Earth observation satellites, and we have got a land and water for this type of satellite, observation satellite, like ResourceSat and ResSat. These micro satellites are the ResourceSat, it's the IR step of satellites which are having it, and which provides resolutions right from 50 meters to you can say 10 meters or less than 1 meter or something like that. And we have got another very high resolution satellite like Cartosat, which you get less than 1 meter resolution. Right now we are having some 60 centimeter resolution, which are having IRS. for cartographic applications with high resolution satellite images. And with regard to ocean parameters, we have got OceanSat, because there is hydrometeorological disaster, some of the origin is ocean. For that thing, ocean parameters, which are very important for cyclone formation and everything, and we have got ocean type of satellite ocean observations and everything. Similarly, we have got altimeters, several Altica, this is altimeter, which gives a mean surface, sea surface, whether we will get it information about it. And we have got weather satellites like INSAT systems, where Suryaprakash also has mentioned INSAT type of satellites and Kalpana, which gives the meteorological. And we have also got communication systems on these INSAT systems, which will give space communications on that and everything. And right, these what we will get it from this satellite pictures is right from 1 kilometers to some few centimeter satellite observations we can make out of it. Apart from Earth observation systems, we have also got regional navigation systems, that is called NAVIC. We have got our own navigational systems, which you'll get your position, which you are going to be there and everything. And Gagan is nothing but GPS aided augmentation. This is initially meant for designed for the aircraft purposes, landing purposes. But however, this Gagan dongle can be used for tracking of location-based services information and everything. Gagan dongles can be utilized and everything. So we have got Earth observation systems, Earth communication systems, as well as the navigational systems which you have got from the space. And what type of satellite data you require to address is depends upon what type of problem you are addressing. When you are looking at a cyclone movement or a convection system which is moving, you require a very high temporal data, high frequency data, and with a continental scale, like INSAT systems, which gives around every 15 minutes, you will get a picture and how the convective system is moving. Because based on that, we know what is going to happen. A moving, build-upping convective system gives a more rainfall than a decaying system. And similarly, cloud top temperatures play a very important role when you are making a rainfall estimations and other things. Where you, and you are addressing this type of things, you require INSAT type of systems. Suppose you want to address a flood problem, which is a large area. What is the inundated area in Brahmaputra basin, which is about 80 kilometers by some 600 to 700 kilometers. For that, you require a large swath image, a single shot. For that, you will get AVIPS type of satellite images, which are having resource at what you are having it. That gives a picture directly. We will give you such type of things, will give you at a single shot, multiple times in every 5 days, we'll get what is happening, and we'll get a resolution of 50 meters and everything. Suppose you go for a district level of disaster management plan, what you are having, you require a medium resolution or a better resolution, 10 meters or something like that, where you get LIS-3 type of sensor data, which will be very useful. Suppose you want to study a location basic information, a breach has occurred, what is the inundation that has taken place. For that, you require a high resolution data like Cartosat, which will going to be there. Apart from that, you require elevation information. For that, we have got a global digital elevation models, which are going to be there. Just I'm going to show in the next couple of minutes also. And why this technology, how to use it? First and foremost thing is it speaks. It will act as a evidence for you to convince what is the damage that has taken place, to understand the situation better. No other thing is required. It is just you are showing an example of 2009, 2013, 2014, and what is the ground picture. You can see nobody need not tell you what is happened. In 2009, they have started a pond in Manrega work, suppose, say, take it an example, is a pond has been created. It audits. You could show the images before the event, after the event, how is present, and how is on the ground picture you want to take and do everything. It speaks. It is a time, energy, love. At a quick time, you can make an entire inventory of that, or maybe you can get a lot of information can be gathered at a single shot, and it will act as an evidence. It will have an added purpose. It will be very useful. And that's why this technology has got a tremendous potential. And this is, we have got a resolution of DEM of 30 meters, which is freely available with the Bhuvan site. ISRO Bhuvan site, you can download, or you can see 10 meters also has been generated for the India as well as the neighboring countries which have been taken, because the Kato digital DEM is one of the very important information which is required by that, which you will get 3D visualizations, which you can see with the building heights and everything. This is an example which I have shown and everything. And this is useful for flood management purpose. How it is means, once you get a high resolution images, this is a modeling using LIDAR. LIDAR is another technology which gives a very high resolution. Cartosat DEM, which is 10 meters, LIDAR gives is 50 centimeters resolution. DEMs can be generated. 1 meter, 50 centimeters, DEMs, digital elevation models can be developed using this thing. Suppose you go, this is Nagapattinam area, when tsunami inundation is going to take place, how for a given event, how it is going to take place, modeling can be done using LIDAR data. And the same thing for floodplains, if you take it, what you can give is Central Water Commission nowadays giving the flood forecast and NHE program also, I think special inundation modeling is also a part of it, I understand, is previously they are giving it with respect to a level. The Brahmaputra is likely to rise to 96.5 or not 4.5. For a common man, it will not communicate anything. What you give, he say and everything. And if you say Charminar is going to be inundated, Qutub Minar is going to, water up to Qutub Minar is going to come up to NADM in Delhi, then people will understand what you have to do it and everything. How you can translate a gauge level information into a spatial domain. Once you get a very high resolution demo of your floodplain, whatever the flood level can be translated and you give a spatial extent. This is the extent of area, because a commissioner or an administrator, we will be able to understand situation, take appropriate action. Once you give which are the villages are going to be affected, which are the areas are going to be affected, so that he can evacuate the people from those areas. That's why you must able to. So this technology, LIDAR technology, will give you, especially in giving a spatial inundation modeling, which are going to be. This is a detailed map of that, which will give the depth of inundation, navigation purpose also. It can be used whatever the part of in summary. District of Godavari, Sabari, tributary of river and everything. And this is what has happened with the recent flooding in Mumbai. About more than 250% excess rainfall has occurred. Today there is a forecast in IMD in Hyderabad, in Telangana. There is going to be heavy rainfall, heavy to very heavy rainfall is going to occur. Don't go out, especially unless it is very urgent. And what you are seeing is satellite pictures of 12th April and everything in 18th April. And if you see in the reports which are taken, especially during the month of July 2001, very excessive rainfall, 250% of excessive rainfall, most of the low-lying areas have been inundated. This is not only case of Brahmaputra in Mumbai, it is in most of the cities. At the same time in July, in Karnataka, there is a heavy rainfall occurred and there is a lot of inundation has been taken place in the river systems and everything. And this type of things is common. Even a few days back in Hyderabad, in the midnight, there is a heavy rainfall occurred and most of the low-lying areas are inundated. People are struggling and everything. What can be done for such type of things? Especially there may be in the participants, there may be some people from the administrator, some people may be academicians are going to be there, research scholars and everything. Please, you can sit down in your house with using internet, you can develop these models. Let me tell you this, what I'm showing this picture. You must be able to identify vulnerable areas. This is exactly has been done when I was in NRSA. During September 2016, there is a heavy rainfall occurred and everything. There is a DCP office very near to our office. And they asked me, sir, there is a situation, can you do or something like that? At that time, you don't have any satellite image and everything. So what you have taken is DEM is there, digital elevation model. And there is called a hand model, that is height above near drainage, which is available, open source is available on the internet. Using that model, we identified which are the areas likely to be inundated for a given amount of rainfall. So we have given two categories. One is our dark blue, where water bodies are there. Red color is immediately is going to be inundated for a given amount of rainfall. And the cyan color, what you are seeing on the screen, is those areas which are going to be affected by rainfall increases. So we have generated this layer, taken a KM and put it on an apartment map of Hyderabad and given a navigation to the police control.
So what they have done, they have taken, when you are moving it, they are seeing the red areas, they are telling the apartment people, if the rainfall is going to be, we have to link this to the rainfall forecast given to by IMDA. IMDA are giving a heavy rainfall. Tonight there is going to be rainfall and your apartment are going to be water moved to the floor, top floors, or maybe vacate this place and everything. Just input of DEM. And this will act as a early warning, a rough early. It may not be exactly whether it has come to up to this appointment or not. That locality which are going to be under that, it is going to be very helpful. This is any academicians or research scholars, they can take up this and generate, and it will be very much appreciated by the particular city or the town, what they're doing it. For any of the areas, they can do it. This we have done. And for entire Hyderabad, we have generated and given it to the government of Telangana. And these spatial technologies will help you to give appropriate product for decision makers, especially when a chief minister takes information, he requires information at a state level. Suppose a PM takes a review meeting about the flood situation, people will take about A3 size map or something like that. In each state, they'll put some red dots or red pins. Sir, these are the areas, these are the states which have been affected. This is the relief mechanism in place. This is the actions of the government and everything. At a small scale, they will give a comprehensive picture. Similarly, a state relief chief ministry want to take entire state. You require a state level information has to be presented. What are the districts have been affected? What is the action of the East incident commander or the incident collectors and everything? And similarly, when you want a district level of information, the collector will take a decision what needs to be done for the particular district. You require district level. When you go to a block level, you will get a very detailed map. This type of information can be utilized using GIS tools or GPS tools as well as satellite images. You can customize the product so that it suits. Similarly, depth maps using DEM, you give a generation maps, cumulative inundation maps, because multiple times people will get the same area is going to be affected. Where there is persistence of inundation, how many days inundation is there and present, because the damage of the crops, it depend upon how many days the crop is under water, and whether it's progressing or receding, what is the cumulative effect of the event, that is a rainfall event or a flood event, how much is the area affected. So the technology provides you to customize a product for a decision maker, for appropriate authority, which you can take it and everything. And he's also asking hazard zonation maps is another type of flood management measure and everything, using historic information, observed satellite images. More than 10 years at that time, we have done recently, they have done using up to 2019. This is a very old slide which I'm showing it. Up to 2019, they updated also. Historic inundation, they have taken it and they have identified which are regularly affected area, which are affected with a different time periods. That is a very low, low, moderate, high. Some classification has been given, and hazard zonation maps have been prepared for Bihar, Orissa, UP, as well as for Assam. And when you have prepared these maps, whatever the maps that have been generated and they have given to the respective state for validation purpose, whatever you do, unless it is being validated by the ground, it is accepted by the people, you can't do anything. So whatever the technologists or the research people, whatever the technology you develop, whatever these model you develop, you ensure it is accepted by the department, concerned department, by the state or by district, so that they implement. Otherwise, your knowledge or your research will limit to publication, or then it goes to Almera. It will not come into the actual effect. My sincere suggestion, those researchers, please kindly, whatever research problem you take it to the near reality. People, most of the people say, we won't get data. You will get data. I have worked with so many research students and everything. You have to go for appropriate way. There is a procedure. You want to data from the government department, there is a way to procure it. Then you have to join hands with the departments or through state government. Sir, this is doing this. So-and-so students is doing for this work. Then you will get the data. Then you can do your more useful work which can be accepted by the people. This is a hazard zonation maps. How many villages are going to be affected in worst every year affected villages. This itself will give you whenever there is going to be heavy rain. Every day, every year there are going to be floods in Brahmaputra. These villages can be put on alert. When the in catchment Dibrugarh there is a flood started, means by the time it comes to Dubri, it comes to about 4.5 days. There is a lot of lag time is available, especially in Brahmaputra. Which are the villages are going to be affected, which you know immediately and everything. And apart from that is a risk assessment. Once you know hazard area of that, and we have got other area, infrastructure area is available, crop area is available, and roads and villages. Use all these other vulnerability parameters and make a risk. What is give a appropriate weightage? Appropriate weightage for the crops and appropriate weightage for infrastructure. And then create a risk assessment, risk maps, which are going to be helpful and everything. You can use a geospatial. And whatever I'm showing is how it is being utilized by these maps by government of Assam, that is Assam Disaster Management Authority, ASDMA. Whatever the atlases we have given, they have combined, they have taken extracts with respect to each districts and prepared a small booklet. This is Morigaon district, a booklet, and given to the district authorities. These are the areas in your district who are going to be affected. These are the suggested measures to minimize the floods. That has been given, what has to be done and everything. And another thing is with respect to water level, what are the likely areas are to be inundated? This is also in Bhuvan for Bihar area, which are given, where you can select a particular river system and give water level, which are the areas are going to be in that online query. This is nothing but an online query, which you can do it and everything. This is a normal flooding which happens in the river and due to heavy rainfall is going to be there. And something which is done in 2004 is most of some of the people who have been knowing is the Parachu Lake. There is a landslide has occurred on the Parachu River and the lake has been formed in 2004. The information at that time, I am the one of the persons who played a very important role in identifying the lake first time by me. There is a information from Satluj Jalavithuligram. There is a lake has been formed in Satluj Basin. Satluj Basin approximately 40,000 square kilometers. A lake has been formed in 40,000 kilometers you have to identify. A call has come around 10:30 in the morning. By 3 o'clock, we are able to locate what is the probable lake. So screened satellite pictures before and after when it is going to be thing. There is a lake, and then we have checked and identified the lake. The next day, we have been summoned to Delhi. And the Joint Secretary is a very dynamic IAS officer. Right now, he's Honorable Minister R.K. Singh. He is the Joint Secretary, DMA, the Disaster Management DM. He has taken this and all the thing, and it is not in our territory. Inaccessible regions, you want the information, this is the only technology which has been available. And we have, remember, we have monitored this leak on a daily basis for more than about 8 months. How the impoundment has taken place, what is the mechanism kept in the downstream area in the event it breaches. There's a block and there is impoundment has taken place about 2000 hectares. And if it is breaches, what is the mechanism has to be in the Lapcha is the boundary, Indo-Tibetan boundary. And below that, early warning mechanism has been created in people in Himachal Pradesh kept on high alert so that there should not be any loss of life and everything. So it is a very huge study which has been done and everything. Finally, it is breached in 2005. In June and everything. Even sometimes you will get a call from the Kinnur district collector, the sir, there is a Parachu is building up again. Please kindly, there's a newspaper. Can you tell? There are incidents after that, very recently, about 4 or 5 years back, also when I was in NRSA, I checked the images. Is there any impoundment has taken place in Parachu? And we have provided, I think I had to rush up. Time is 3:30 as per the schedule. I don't know. And another Lahore Spiti landslide, which have taken place on 13th August, which has he is also mentioning what has happened and everything. And there is a blockade that has taken place on the Chandrabhaga river system. And this also subsequently, fortunately, it has cleared on 16th. So the water has moved. So this is how the impoundment has taken place and everything. That also we can see on 14th satellite picture, 13th there is a landslide has occurred, and whatever the impoundment, subsequently it is cleared, there is 16th. It is available in NRC website, which you can see it. And this is another Kinnoor landslide. There is a lot of people have died. There is a lot of people have died in Kinnoor landslide, and there is a bus, if I remember correctly, there is a bus, a 30-seater bus, the landslide has occurred and everything. And why I'm telling is they have kept, why I'm showing the earlier slides is, sometime quite long back in 2003, when Malpa tragedy has taken place, there is a request from Cabinet Secretary to create a landslide hazard zonation maps along the pilgrim routes in Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. It has been prepared. Landslide hazards and maps have been prepared using satellite and other associated technologies, and there is a management practices map has been prepared. What type of measure has to be taken to minimize the landslide associated with the terracing has to be done, or slope stabilization has to take place, or drainage has to be improved, terracing has to be done. These maps have been given to district authorities. These maps needs to be utilized. It is a need of the hour. If they want updations, they can ask the concerned department to update these maps and everything. Because there are so many recent slides I'm not covering. Because if I start one event, I can cover one. Even Paraji itself, I can give a half an hour to 1 hour lecture. So, but these events have increased, especially in the Himalayan terrains. This needs to be brought into the force to be more productive use and everything. There is a early warning also is being given landslide. There is no operational early warning mechanism available for landslide, but still there is a warning has been given. ISRO Bhavan site, there is a landslide early warning. It's an experimental, people said, just you see it, keep a watch. If it is not agreeing, sorry, whatever you're given is not matching, you improve your methodology so that at least you will give, if there is a warning, at least the traffic can be on the route can be minimized, because the collector has to take a decision. Tourism is the most revenue for these pilgrim areas. And whether to run the bus or not, if you run the bus, a landslide occurs, what has happened a few days back in February 13, the same thing will go to happen. So you have to take a decision. What is the information is available with you is, at least there is a warning, there is a landslide warning on the pilgrim routes, then they can take a decision. And another thing, now I should really rush. And 10 years back, I'm taking back 2008, there is a breach in embankments, because the structural flood management, where there is a breach which has occurred, and entire water, this is happened in near above Birpur, that is in the Nepal area, and a lot of inundation has taken place in Bihar, which are taken. These are the inundation maps have been created out of that. I'm not going to cover. This is the persistence of inundation which has taken how many villages. The important point of that is, whatever the embankment they have plugged in, they have taken. You can, using the satellite images, you can monitor the progression of the structural flood control works like embankments and spurs, which you can do it. But the most important, interesting part which I want to mention is, we have made a study. River conformation maps will make it. Geomorphological Division of Central Water Commission, or maybe if I do not know with whom it is there now, the river conformation maps. Why you are required is how the river conformation is there. Kosi is embanked. When you see from 2003 to 2008, the water active stream is coming to the embankment area, and it is hugging in 2008, which finally led to the breach. If you know in advance the river configuration, whenever you construct an embankment, we have to see, is there any threat that is coming into this embankment? And you can see very clearly, prior to the breach and after the breach, pre-breach, these are the spurs, and this is previously the active channel is this side, now it is coming to this side, which is going to be there. So you have to keep a watch on the structural measures which have been constructed, so that a disaster of this breach type of things cannot occur and everything. Another major event that has occurred in 2007 is the Tapovanam, whatever been And in 7th February 2020, there is a rock slide called Avalanche, which has taken place in Rainigani village in Chamoli district. And there is a flash flood occurred in the Rishiganga and Dauliganga region. And this power plant has got a lot of damages. These are the pictures. What are the details of the pictures of the damage, Louis Gates, where the water has come and everything. These things. And investigative study where this has taken place. Surya Prakash is mentioning, already has given a very good detailed picture of that. People might have seen it and everything. Where it has occurred, the rock slides and everything, before and after and everything. This is September 2020, where this rock slide has taken place and everything. Just before that 5th February, there is a cracks which have been developed and everything. This is the post rock slide image which have taken place and everything. You can see a detailed picture of that, the suspected avalanche which has taken place and created the damage within Tapovanam area after other things. There is a blockade and the impoundment which is also mentioning about it, approximately about 880 meters impoundment of more than 100 meters. There is a width of the channel which has taken place in Rishiganga area, Rishiganga River. And one of the very important developments, we have seen some of the disasters. Government also taking equally good care of it. In under MHA, under this NHP project, National Hydrology Project, there is a one element called is the glacial outburst lake and everything. Inventory of the lakes in Himalayan basins have been created. There is an atlas has been, glacial lake atlas has been made, and it is being released by the Ministry of Water Resources. Similarly, NDME also has made guidelines how to address the Gulf. These are the positive signs which have taken place to minimize the disasters of that event, but still much more needs to be done. We are bringing the landslide susceptibility, landslide hazard assessment risk brought into the picture, so that and ranking of these glacial lakes, what are the likely chances that it has to come on to everything. See, another thing is a Thatke cyclone, which has started in some May 14, 2021, and dissipated in the west coast of India. There is a lot of damages have taken place. And because of flood management, also a part of heavy rainfall that is occurred due to the cyclones also created these Gujarat state, what are seeing, these are the dark patches are the inundated areas in part of Brahmaputra and part of Gujarat. And a little bit more detailed pictures I'm having, I will cursorily go through with the point permission from the organizers to give me another 5 minutes, I'll close it. And the cyclone was, pardon?
Yes,
okay,
sir, please go ahead.
Sure, sir. Yeah. Sorry, 1 hour I planned, so suddenly when I saw the schedule is, and this is the total tree canopy roof damages which have taken place in the Kanchipuram districts. We have taken, these are from the satellite images, we have mapped all these things, and the damages have been identified and everything. High resolution satellite images. In the beginning, when I have shown what type of satellite data required for what type of purposes, high resolution data for location breach and location or something like that. Suppose you want to do a structural damage due to a cyclone, you require a cartosat images. That means a sub-meter resolution satellite images you require. So wherever the rooftop damages that have taken place due to the cyclone, which have been identified from the satellite pictures. And these are the damages that is steel plant, Kamal steel plant in Madrajnagar of Tamil Nadu, I think it has occurred and everything. And people have gone to the site using GPS mobile, taken pictures of that particular area to correlate those pictures with the satellite images and integrate for assessing a total damage. That is very important. Whenever you, most of the people, they will ask me what, whether you can identify human being from satellite image, whether you can identify, these are the questions. The amount of information you extract from the image is not with respect to image, with respect to your knowledge. We have given 1990, what are the coconut, number of coconut production loss due to the 1990 cyclone of Kakinada. How you have given, at the time, 30 meters resolution. 30 meters, you can't see anything. You can't, coconut tree also, we can't see it. What we have taken? We have taken the coconut crop area. We have taken the damaged coconut crop area. In the damage control area, people have gone to the ground, 10 teams have gone to the about to 10 sites. They have taken how many, how much is the ground damage, how many with fallen, how many trees are not damaged. They have made a classification. These taken 100 samples. They have taken, taking that sample, they integrate the total affected area, how many trees have fallen, how many trees have the crown damage, how many trees are not affected. Each tree gives a 100 coconuts as annual yield. You are given what is the production loss to the coconut. So the amount of information you will get at a samples at a particular area, integrate with this total area, you will get it. So this type of technology, it is a people are going back to is a integration of technologies. Today you are giving a navigation, you are going from one place to one to place to using a mobile navigation. It's nothing but internet communication as well as GIS map you are having, and communication technology, internet technology, and navigation technology. Three have been combined, you are able to deliver things and you are able to move. So whatever is required is the integration of technologies, various technologies, remote sensing, GIS, GPS, and everything. And these technologies have been created, National Database for Emergency Management. I will not, there is no time for this to cover. It itself is a topic. NRC.ndm.nrc.gov.in. There is a slide I have given in the last slide also. People, you can type on your mobile, you will get the site. There is a login. If you thought login also, there is a huge information about the alerts, about the flood alerts or the cyclone alerts, social media inputs. Lot of things are available even before login itself. You can see it and everything. And if anybody is interested, the state government, there is a procedure, ask for a login for a specific purpose. I got an opportunity with the MHA to work on the implementation. I implemented this National Database for Emergency Management and everything. What you can do with this is there is a dashboard. There are disaster-related warnings, historic events, all this information is available. You can report an incident using this and everything. You can visualize the data. There are decision support tools that are available on this. You can take a decision which is the nearest hospital available, what is the optimum route from point one to point two or whatever this thing is there. And you can communicate through this portal. It is no mail server as well. It is only purely to database. It is a secured communication. We can do it. Resource management. Suppose what are the resources has to be deployed to the field that can be planned. And IDR, that is India Disaster Resource Network. There is a UNDP collaboration with MHA. They have done that. Also has been integrated. Where are your cutters? Where are your bulldozers? Such type of things. There is a mobile application apps which have been for reporting from the field, which will go into the portal and inventory. There's a lot of much more information. Recently, there is a version 3. This is the old slide I'm showing it. This type of things which are going to it. This is a very huge database is available on this portal. I will not come more details. And to give how powerful is this portal, we have given a customized this portal to NDRF. You have given NDRF, there is a virtual event, there is a building collapse has happened when they came for training to NRSA. We have asked them, there is a building collapse has been taken. Your time starts now. Using this portal, you have to locate where it is. You have to go there, call the relief mechanism onto that, rescue the people, and then close the event and report back. Your time starts now. From that incident, these are the logs which have been reported when the incident reported. They made a dummy calls for fire engine or a cutter or a bulldozer. Then they have gone to the ground. They have taken few people to the nearest hospital. Of course, your person is dummy. They are going to the hospital is real. They have taken to the hospital. They got admitted. And they are able to connect to Delhi as well as NRSA control room and the field. They have completed the event. Every event is logged. At what time in 2016, 2014, 2023 to the event, they have taken approval for closing the event, coming back using this portal. There's a live demonstration which have been done and everything. And ISRO Bhuvan, please kindly visit a Bhuvan site. There is a lot of things is available, lot of data, research people, especially I want to, lot of geospatial data is available on Bhuvan. You can create your own, customize your own Bhuvan. and you can create a GIS layer into the Bhuvan itself, and you can mobile data will land onto the Bhuvan. There are so many services are available. ISRO Bhuvan, if anybody wants a training on Bhuvan, they can write to NRSA director, we want a Bhuvan training. They'll come and they'll organize it. I believe it. I am not there in force right now. But when we are there, even today, they are encouraging a lot for academic institutions as well as the government and state government people. They want to utilize the Bhuvan. They will definitely come and help and everything. There are going to be a lot of information. Whatever the information are taken from our ISRO site as well as Bhuvan and the NDM site, which you can see it, and NRSA site also has been taken. And at this time, I will close my lecture. And if any further clarifications or questions, I acknowledge my colleagues, and you can call bhanu634@gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you so much,
shall
sir.
Shall I close the application?
So you can close the PowerPoint application only.
Yeah.
So now, as I mentioned, that satellite remote sensing and GIS, they are serving as a powerful tool, I think, which helps to create and manage the spatial and non-spatial data.
Okay.
As mentioned by Professor Surya Prakash and by Dr. Bhanu, So as mentioned by Sir and Professor Surya Prakash regarding the Chamoli disaster. So there was one project, Tapovan Power Project. Also, sir mentioned regarding this, the satellite imagery data was being shared by sir. So that project, I must say, that's been in construction from past 15 years. And we had already witnessed 3 major episodes of flooding there, but still doesn't have a functional early warning system that could have alerted the workers to an impending flood. So there is very much need of the hour to design a powerful, at least such kind of early warning system that worked effectively. Sir, we have one question. So if you permit, may I ask the question?
Please.
Sir, it is how to select the satellite data.
How to get the satellite data?
Yes, sir. Select the satellite data.
Yeah, there is a called NRSA data center which supplies these data. If anybody wants to write a letter to NRSA data center, there is an email, sales, it is available in NRSA website, sales@nrsa.gov.in, if I remember correctly. They can take, I want this purpose, I want appropriate satellite. Some of the data is available on Bhuvan, you can download, you can use it directly.
Okay, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay, because I am not seeing anybody on the line and no response is coming. Okay, next question.
We were speaking, so I think there was some technical glitch. Sir, there's one more question. Recently asked, let me share the question. Okay. So the question is, what are the specific measures that are being taken to address any disaster in tourist safety or tourism industry point of view?
Industry point of view?
Yes, sir. Tourist industry point of view.
Your voice is breaking.
Sir, am I audible now?
In towards industry point of view, you want, it depend upon what type of industry you are. You are audible. In industry point of view, what is the satellite? What is the data you have to require? Means you are looking for what type of industry? First of all, if you take a nuclear power plant, the data and the mechanism we have to address is totally different. There is a nuclear emergency plan which has to be developed. Of course, NRSA has done it and everything with regard to the power plant. And if it's a hydropower plant, it's totally different. If you take another chemical industry, that is totally different. So it depends, what type of mechanism is to be depends upon the type of, suppose say any release of poisonous gases in the polymers which has taken in Visakhapatnam or in Bhopal, you have to have a mechanism to detect any leakage of gases. If you take a power plant, any leakage of nuclear, in hydropower plants, is there any anticipated flash flood that is coming, as you are mentioning, early warning mechanism? It depends upon what industry you are addressing and what location you are addressing. For that, what type of need mechanism to be made? For that, what data you need? That is, it depends upon it. There won't be anything you require a Cartosat satellite image data. No, it is not like that. I hope what I understand is what type of industry, what type of satellite data with regard to industry you are asking. I hope I am clear.
Yes, sir, sort of. The question addresses the same thing. Sir, that's all from the participant side. So thank you so much, sir, once again for joining with us. I request Dr. Amrit Lal Haldar to please place a vote of thanks for this, sir. Dr. Haldar, over to you.
Okay.
Dipali,
yes, sir.
Our vote of thanks will be given lastly. Before that, if you are ready, or
I will start.
At the last, it will be given.
I will be online. Don't worry.
Okay. No problem. So, Dipali, okay. You can continue, sir, for a few minutes. Okay.
Okay, sir. Sure.
Now I can put your introduction in the meantime.
Sure, sir.
So it is very, very, very exhaustive talk and very nice information for geospatial technology, even for LIDAR technology also. He has given a lot of things, a lot of information, how not only the remote sensing and GIS, but LIDAR technology has done, even entire life, whatever he has achieved, especially in the space technology, he has tried to give him within the short span of time. So now the second one more lecture will be there. It will be given by Dipali Jindal. And basically, he's recently he has joined in NIDM few months back, and who is doing the work on landslide. And he has his master, she has her master from IIT Roorkee on disaster mitigation and management. And after that, she is pursuing the PhD also in Roorkee, IIT Roorkee. And he has gained a lot of knowledge in the landslide also. Presently, she is involved in NIDM, that is the archival records of documentation of socio-economic significant landslides in India. She is currently involved in that. Apart from that, she is also working in flood and other things also. From her experience, she'll try to speak regarding the flood vulnerability. Now with this, I request Dipali, you can carry on. You take the stage as per your own convenience and try to finish it by 4 o'clock. Okay, carry on, Dipali.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving such a nice introduction. Sir, my screen is visible?
Yes, beautifully, nicely, it is. You can go ahead, it's going on.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So now I would like to give the presentation on the topic flood vulnerability. As already being discussed by the sir, the types of the floods, the cascading disaster due to the floods, and how we can measure or monitor the floods either in terms of the point cloud data or the digital elevation model. So before going any sort of the experimental work or the simulation works, we need to understand the ground truth or to understand the basics or the scratch of something. So many times you have heard about the terminology disaster, risk, hazard, vulnerability. So now we will be discussing today the terminology, the flood vulnerability. So in this regard, many definitions are being there. So one of the definitions states that if a community or a system, so my slide is moving. Haldar sir.
Paliji, it is moving, yeah.
Okay.
We can see your slide.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Can you change, try a change again?
Sir, I have changed the slide.
Yeah, it's working.
Okay, sir, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So when we talk about the vulnerability, so we can define the vulnerability in the terms like if a community or system or an asset that is susceptible to the damaging effects of a particular hazard under any sort of characteristics or the circumstances, it is termed as vulnerable. Also, the definition as given by the United Nations International Strategy for Disaster Reduction, vulnerability is the physical, social, economic, and environmental aspects which make the exposed elements susceptible to the impacts of a hazard. So when these hazards are turned into disasters, we usually heard the term hazard, Hazard is converted into disaster. So when it happens, it happens when if the hazard, if the event that impact a society that is vulnerable to their effects. So for more clear understanding, let's take an example. If there is a mountain and a huge boulder is toppling over there. So beneath it, in the photograph, we are able to see there is a house in which the family members are there. And nearby to the house, there is one calf. So when this event is about to occur, or the potential of the event to occur, so the people or the livestock, which is beneath this mountain area, so these are vulnerable people. So there is a need to understand the vulnerability, and understanding the vulnerability is very crucial criteria, because if we understand the vulnerability, we are able to promote disaster resilient societies, which can be leading to more effective mitigation and preparedness strategies. And if we talk about the flood, in terms of the flood, the vulnerability is the extent to which a system is susceptible to the flood due to exposure or anxiety or in congestion when its ability to cope. So for the flood impact, we have the impact of the floods are different. It can be a direct impact or the indirect impact. And further, these can be further divided into tangible or intangible categories. Tangible categories illustrates like the damage to the property, infrastructure, agriculture, and intangible, it's like the evacuation system, ecosystem, cultural heritage. Also, when we talk about the indirect damage, these are further divided into tangible and intangible. In the intangible category, we have the psychological stress, migration stress, etc. So whenever any sort of the disaster happens, not specifically the flood, so what happens, there's an impact on the social behavior of the human being also. That's a psychological impact. So there are different effects of a particular disaster or flood whenever it happens to a particular society or a community. For example, when we talk about the flood loss of the building, in the picture we can see at the center it's showing the loss ratio buildings. So the loss of the buildings, this has been divided into two categories, impact and resistance. So what is the impact? Why the loss of the building is happening? When the hydrological load is increasing. Hydrological load is increasing because it can happen due to the increase in the flow velocity. If, for example, once again, I would like to cite the example of the Chamoli disaster only, the Tapovan project, suppose. Or is what happened to this? The velocity of the water was very high, so it increased to the hydrological load, the duration of the flood, the water level. So all these things, when these are happening, these are leading to the increase in the hydrological load, which then further impact to the loss of the buildings. Similarly, when we talk about the resistance, resistance can be temporal resistance or the permanent resistance. So these can be divided based on the usage of the building material, the precautionary measures which we have used, the type of the building which we have constructed in the flood prone area. So all these things affect the number of the loss of the buildings in a particular area because of the flood. Now the question arises, who all are vulnerable? The people who are living or inhabited in a hazard prone area, those have less capacity to withstand any disturbance, and those who personally handicapped, discriminated, or less access to the normal treatment, these people are majorly vulnerable to the disasters or the floods. So if you look at the flood damage statistics of India, so this is the image which I have taken from the Central Water Commission website. So this is the image which is depicting or illustrating the annual average flood damage from the year 1953 to 2019. So in this, we are able to see the total crop area affected in these particular range. That was 4.02 mega hectare area affected and the population affected. Similarly, if we talk about the flood prone areas in the different states, the flood prone area in the different states of India. So in the average area affected by the floods annually, it's about 8 million hectares, covering Uttar Pradesh with 21.9%, Bihar 12.71%, Assam 9.4%, and West Bengal 7.9%, Orissa 4.18%, and other states have 43.9% of the flood-prone area. So this was the statistics of the flood prone area in the different states of India. Now, as we were talking about the vulnerability, so to understand the vulnerability, I came across a literature, and in that literature, I found a vulnerability framework. So I would like to explain the vulnerability framework. The vulnerability framework is being divided into four categories. That is the threshold capacity, coping capacity, recovery capacity, and the adaptive capacity. So these all capacities are being described in terms of the type, time orientation, uncertainty of the hazard, magnitude, and the responsibility. So one by one, we will be discussing in brief regarding these capacities. For example, threshold capacity. Threshold capacity is basically the capacity with an objective of building a prevention of damage. In the last image, we have seen the type. It's written damage prevention. So it is the ability of a particular society to build up a threshold against variation in order to prevent the damage. Similarly, if we talk about the coping capacity is the capacity of a society to reduce the damage in case of the disturbance that exceeds the damage threshold. So if we see like this, the objective of coping capacity is the reduction. Threshold capacity is for prevention of the damage. Coping capacity is for damage reduction. Next, we have with us the recovery capacity. Recovery capacity is the third component that refers to the capacity of a society to recover to some or equivalent status before the emergency. It is the capacity of the flooded area to reconstruct the buildings or infrastructure or the dikes. So the objective of this recovery capacity is to develop and increase as quickly and effectively, or respond to the particular disaster as effectively we can. The last one comes the adaptive capacity. Adaptive capacity is the capacity of a particular nation or a community that is living in a river basin or even the world to cope with and adjust to certain future developments and catastrophic, not frequently occurring disturbances such as extreme floods. So when we look at this picture, that is the table. So in this, we are able to see the different capacities are there. So in the time orientation also, it's written past, instantaneous, instantaneous future, and the future. So depending upon the reaction of a particular capacity, the time orientation has been specified in this. For example, in case of the threshold capacity, the time horizon lies in the past. That means the past disaster experiences of a particular society. As we say, from the past lessons only we are able to learn. Similarly, in the threshold capacity, from the past disaster experiences only of a particular society, these becomes the guiding principle to determine the height of the threshold. In the coping capacity, it is instantaneous, because in emergency, what happens? It's like only here and now. Jahan bhi disaster hota hai, it's like our first priority, we have to cope up from that. From which particular area we have to focus or we have to start. So it's in that way. Next is the recovering capacity. In recovering capacity also, it's instantaneous, because right after the disaster, but it's instantaneous recovery, but it will change gradually towards the generation of the or the development on the future perspective. And the last one is adaptive capacity. In this, what happens, the time orientation lies in the future, because it's because of the uncertain future developments and the catastrophic events. So this was the image which is depicting the four components and the domains of the vulnerability framework, illustrated by the damage return period graph. These three domains are interrelated. Now I would like to explain how. What happens actually, we have in this threshold domain, coping recovery domain, and adaptive domain. So this the first point is threshold domain. So what happens, the vulnerability components are highly connected in this way. The connection between the components, which is presented in this, it's a conceptual damage. Conceptual damage means even if thresholds have been built, there will be some occasions when the threshold will be exceeded. Suppose we have mentioned the threshold, it's like ki, is particular level tak hamara water nahi exceed karega. So it's a threshold domain. So once the threshold exceeds, it converts to the damage threshold or the reduction. Then coping with the hazard impacts and recovering from them is necessary. This is the coping and the recovery domain in which the damage reduction is the prime goal. Finally, they are very unlikely events with very high return period where the expected damage is that extreme that recovery is neither feasible nor possible. So these type of the occasions we want to prevent by adapting. Therefore, this is a adaptive domain. This figure also illustrates that by increasing only the threshold domain, for instance, by building higher and stronger dikes, the coping and recovery domain become smaller. So these domains are important, and by coping and recovering, people become aware of the risk, and the approach that only focuses on increasing the threshold capacity results in the system that is increasingly vulnerable to the occurring disasters. So the conclusion of the whole flood vulnerability presentation is the vulnerability components are strongly interrelated, because as soon as it increases the or passes the threshold domain, it gets converted to the coping domain. And for a vulnerability decreasing strategy, it is necessary to include all the four components of vulnerability, and emergency plans, improved risk communication, and possible coping capacity. Ensuring flood risk or setting up disaster compensation funds could increase recovery capacity in the flood risk management. So with this, I would like to end my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dipali. Very nicely you have elaborated regarding the flood vulnerability, flood risk and management. What are the things in details way you have given? And really, it is the interesting topic, interesting matters you have explained for the those who are the newcomers and those also in the field for the to enhance the knowledge. Now, I would request you, please, he is in attendees list. You please bring him to panelist. Our executive director Manoj Kumar Bindalji. In the alphabetically go in M, he is there. I have confirmed. So please make him panelist. Now, immediately after that, we'll continue the rest one. Course one validity function will be
held. Sir, just a minute. I'm making him panelist. Done, sir. I have made him the panelist. A very good afternoon to Major General M.K. Mindal, sir. Sir, we welcome you in our webinar. Sir, am I audible? Hello, sir. May I proceed? Sorry, participants, and sorry, panelists, because of the some technical glitch. I think there was some faulty connection, so I got disconnected. So starting once again, I, on behalf of NIGM and GMR division and all the participants, I welcome our Major General M.K. Mindal, Executive Director, National Institute of Disaster Management. He's an alumnus of the National Defense Academy, and he's a graduate of the Defense Services Staff College and has attended the prestigious Higher Command course at the Army War College, besides excelling in all other career courses in the Army. So without any further delay, I call upon our Honorable ED sir on this virtual platform.
Dipali, just to intervene to you, that suddenly he got a call from the government and he left the office right 2 minutes back only. So okay, now okay. We have to conclude with that. In some other day, we'll give the time. So we are very sorry and apologize for the people. And you can take this thing. Now we can start the vote of thanks. So please, you convey this message.
Okay. So moving ahead.
Yes.
Moving ahead. Sorry, we were unable to have the Major General M.K. Bindal sir with us. He's the Executive Director of NIDM. We were so fortunate to have him on this platform, but due to some urgency, he has left the office. So now moving ahead towards the end of the session, I request Dr. Amritlal Haldar to kindly place the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Yes. Dipali, thank you. Now it is a privilege for me to put the vote of thanks, starting from our big scientist from ex-NRSC associate director, and he was also director in National Disaster Response Wing. And so it is a great day for this NIDM that is eminent scientist, that Dr. Bhanumurthy, he was here, who is having 37 years service in NRSC, and he has did a lot of work and which are the excellence in category on different kind of disaster. And today he has explained us very precisely, very nicely, the geospatial technology, how it will be useful for the flood management. And not only this flood also, but also from landslide, how the landslide hazard map could be prepared. He has given the beautiful example and the phenomena of Uttarakhand flood, what happens, and glacial lake blast and certain things. And even he could not forget that that happened in 2013. That is the temple, Kedarnath temple, how the tragedy was happened and what are the causes. And he also remembered that at that time people are evacuated through the space only, because so much blocking and in all the direction except space, that all are evacuated, all are being lifted through the space only. Now, in the similar way, that Eastern UP is very much vulnerable for flood. And in this year also, yesterday, it was a havoc flood, unlike 1998. At that time, more than 20,000 villages were inundated. And yesterday, that sudden flood is there, and especially in Maharajganj district. And a havoc scenario has been created, not like that 1998, but it is there still in grim. I cannot say the statistics right now, but what I heard from the UP people. And this is next to that unfortunately, that our Major General Bindal sir, he left for the government office just 5 minutes back only, and he was listening our lecture, even our expert's lecture, he has listened, but suddenly that call is there and he has to get it. And always he has give us support to conduct this type of seminar, webinar, to propagate the message for the public and attendees and panelists also. And next, we are very much thankful to him also for providing a nice platform to this NIDM, each and every, the speakers and outsiders also. Now, third is that our head of department, Professor Surya Prakash, he's the head of GMRD, and he's rich in knowledge. And always he used to encourage one-to-one person that to pick up the topic and give the different relevant topics of disaster in front of public. And accordingly, he's supporting all the way, day and night. Next is our panelist, that Anil Kathet, that Harihar, Dr. Raju Thapa, Dr. Harjit Kaur, other panelists are also there, Ajit Batham, and so they are also always there supporting, and they are here, they have participated in this forum. And that our rest is that our attendees, that since beginning, they are enthusiastically, they're listening to us, and always they are very peacefully there to listen, and they raise the question through that, and definitely we are thankful for that. Least or not the last, at last, that is the our the supporting staff, that is for IT and other engineers who has put their support in proper way so that this seminar is very much successful. Now once and all, and if anybody had forgotten to put the vote of thanks, I'm definitely eager to put their support acknowledged, and in future also we'll be conducting this type of webinar, especially for the disaster management. Will be need your help for all of them. Thank you very much, sir, in this moment. Over to you, Dipali.
Thank you so much, sir. So with this, we are heading towards over the ending of this session of this webinar. I request all the participants to kindly enroll themselves in the training portal of the NIDM to get the future updates regarding the webinar or the training sessions. So thank you so much once again. Thank you, sir, for joining us. Thank you, the convener of this program, Dr. Amritlal Hadar. I think he has not mentioned his name in the vote of thanks. So thank you so much, sir, for conducting and organizing such a beautiful webinar for the participants and for us also. So thank you once again, everyone. Thank you for joining. And just for the information, there is no attendance link here. So where you have registered yourself in the training portal in the NIDM, you need to go there and give your feedback, and further you can download your certificate. Thank you so much once again. Stay positive, stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll take leave. Okay.